Have you ever fallen really hard for someone who was extremely physically attractive and seemed like the perfect package for your life, only to realize after obtaining their affection that they were extremely flawed and, quite honestly, annoying to be with? That pretty much sums up my relationship with the Microsoft Surface Duo. Let me begin by saying I purchased this phone at full price, $1,299, and got it the day it was available to consumers like you and me. So I've had plenty of time to get properly acquainted with the Duo and all of its quirks. In many ways, the Surface Duo actually is my perfect phone. It's not something the majority of the population will ever see in public. It's rare, it's different, it's an eye catcher. And in a sea of iPhone and Samsung candy bars, this is a yacht floating in the middle of a lake by itself. That's also where things begin to fall apart for the Duo. While a marvel to look at on a design level, the practicality of this phone fails to address the actual needs of the user. Let's first dig into the dual 5.6-inch displays, which when combined together becomes an 8.1-inch screen, good for a resolution of 1800 by 2700p. That sounds like a magnificent viewing experience, except that it isn't. You should never view things in full screen because it's unusable. Let me explain in depth as an everyday user of the Duo for just about every imaginable purpose you'd use a smartphone for. While this is one of the best hinges on a folding phone I have used to date, it doubles up as a divider between the two displays. There's no way around it. When you design a phone in a book shape like this, herein lies the main issue with the Surface Duo that will serve as an overarching nemesis for this hardware: software optimization. No app developer will dedicate any effort to code their software for a form factor unless that form factor is worth their time and their money. This isn't it. In just about every app other than Google Play Books, you will lose significant information using both displays together. Entire words vanishing as the sentence you're reading approaches the Great Wall of Duo. People's faces deform symmetrically, while buttons you need to press are unfortunately placed right in no man's land, unable to have their user navigate further. That's what it's like using this phone with apps enlarged to both displays. This is unfortunate as a user because I did get to see a glimpse of how this form factor could ultimately be rewarded if an app developer specifically altered their code for a phone like this. This is evident with the beautiful synergy of Google Play Books, where the Great Wall of Duo integrates itself as the spine of a physical book, perfectly separating the pages of a novel as if you were traditionally reading. The pages also animate and flip to the next page as you turn the page, just like paper would. Sometimes, though, I had to remind myself that the full screen experience shouldn't deter me from the fact that I actually have two fully functional screens in the first place to use. It's an illusion for sure. I will mention that, you know, these two individual AMOLED screens are in a 3:2 aspect ratio, which once again isn't really properly utilized by a lot of apps. This is especially illustrated with Instagram cutting vital information out for IG stories. In terms of actual enjoyability of the viewing experience, I think these two AMOLED displays are actually of pretty great quality. Colors are cleanly reproduced and the images are plenty sharp for my standards. The viewing angles are also worthy of a flagship. Another thing that is absolutely worthy of a flagship price tag is the build quality. This phone just feels special. I've had this phone in my pocket every day since launch, and it's held up better than I would have expected a phone completely sided with glass would hold up. Think about it this way. There are four surfaces, no pun intended, on this phone, and all of them are glass. That's not something most people can claim their phone has, yet that's exactly what this phone has. Gorilla Glass 5 really has kept this phone in rather good shape for something I would have deemed a hazard, especially as there aren't really any cases. There's no case makers making cases for this phone's unique form factor. All you really have to rely on is the provided dual bumper case, which is a rubberized silicone that isn't too intrusive to the functionality of the phone, but doesn't really do much to protect it. This is a very well-built and beautifully designed phone. More than a month later, I still marvel at how thin this phone actually is, even when folded. It's legitimately thinner when the two screens are folded together than some phones with only one display without a hinge. Although the phone is shockingly thin, the width makes this a little difficult to pull in and out of a pant pocket for men, at least. It's a Nintendo 2DS XL size, and the design of the Duo seriously is its potentially lasting impact on gadget history because it doesn't really do anything else well at all. Due to this clamshell form factor, Microsoft chose not to place a camera sensor on the outside of the clamshell, instead placing the sole 11 megapixel f2.0 sensor where you would traditionally classify as a front-facing position. This might be blasphemy for me to suggest, but it might have been a better idea for Microsoft not to have included a camera on this phone and extended the screen real estate into the bezel instead. You know why? Because the camera performance on the Surface Duo is absolute garbage. It's as if we were thrusted back into 2013 in both quality of the images and the app experience. The shutter is archaic and more often than not gives you a blur of a mess of a result. Exposure compensation, focus points, dynamic range, and just about anything of value to obtaining good images is below average on the Duo. Factor in the frustrating task of folding the phone outwards to shoot it as a rear camera, and it's enough to drive anybody crazy. I had an afternoon where I was getting into my car about to leave work when a big-eyed, crazy-looking squirrel sat perched on a palm tree, locking eyes directly with me while I was in my driver's seat. And I wanted badly, I wanted so badly to capture that moment, so I popped out my untrusty Duo and opened the camera app and flipped the phone, expecting the screen without the camera to populate with the viewfinder like it's supposed to. It didn't. I reverted back to populating both of the screens to try to do it again, do that whole motion again. Nope. But by the fifth attempt, the squirrel said, "Forget you, you're taking too long," and hurried off onto oncoming traffic where I really hope it didn't become roadkill. Welcome to the life of a Surface Duo photographer. On the off chance you do get the camera viewfinder to flip on the first try, there's also a very noticeable delay. I do want to add that this is without a doubt a software issue where a majority of the issues with this phone revolve around. Yet, that can't be an excuse for a consumer product that is actually on a product line right now and available for a common folk like you and me to purchase. This is just, it's not acceptable. Speaking of which, last year's Qualcomm flagship chip, the Snapdragon 855, powers the Surface Duo. While this processor has given me plenty of good memories in 2019, it has unfortunately left me with a sour feeling thanks to the Surface Duo. In theory, operating two apps simultaneously side by side sounds like a multitasking bliss. In reality, it's a functional hell. Why in the world did I get my hopes up that it could possibly do the same with two intensive apps with only 6 GB of RAM and the same Adreno 640 GPU we've seen on all other Snapdragon 855 phones? That's because I tricked my brain into falling in love with the idea of the Surface Duo instead of the logic behind the technology. Don't take this the wrong way though. Like I said, the Surface Duo can handle most tasks you throw at it as long as the other screen is stationary on your home screen. You can still use this on the flagship level performance of yesteryear if you use it that way. You just have to do it on one screen at a time. And if that's the case, then what's the point of buying this phone in the first place? It's supposed to be multitasking. One example I like using is when I play a mobile RPG game on one display while browsing Reddit for tier lists or watching a YouTube tutorial video at the same time. Yes, you can actually do these combinations and be relatively happy with it for a time, but I can't say I was ever actually enjoying the overall experience. For one, the glass that your hand is holding gets uncomfortably hot after a short period of time playing games or streaming videos. That attributes to the eventual performance throttling and noticeably drops the frames in games. Combine that with the oversensitive auto-rotate sensor and the overly common random black screens that require you to close the lid, and you have a recipe for frustration. I don't want to also forget that the white screen of death also happens all the time to me. Sometimes the phone just decides to give you a heart attack unprovoked and randomly crashes into a white screen for like 3 to 4 minutes before eventually rebooting. It has happened to me at least 3 times, and those are only what I could see in person with the phone in hand, so it might have happened in my pocket. The 3577 milliamp hour battery is also one that is frustrating for me considering this phone doesn't support wireless charging and it's well above $1,000. I've gotten into a routine of needing to plug the Duo into its USB-C charging slot twice a day. I'm squeezing maybe 3 hours of screen on time and not even 6 hours off a brick. It is important to note that my app suite and usage may be more extreme than the average user, but the whole point of this phone is that it provides you a second screen to use a second app while your first app does its own thing, right? So it's logical for me to use this and push it even harder, and the battery life just doesn't hold up. Look, it's not all bad though. The side-mounted fingerprint scanner is quite good. I have rarely missed readings. Like, this actually works really well. And I have documented my issues with Sony's side-mounted fingerprint scanners over the years, but I haven't gotten new thumbs or fingers, so whatever Microsoft used here, it works fine with my fingers. And although I seem to have a lot of ill memories with the performance of the Duo, there are moments where I'm truly amazed at what I'm actually doing with this phone. It takes time to find like the quirks that suit your workflow, and one that I found was folding the phone and the first screen 80% back while holding the phone with one hand. Your fingers are lodged between the two glass lids, and it provides some really stable grasp for you to read whatever it is you're reading. This is actually the position I use this phone in a majority of the time. I can't explain why it's comfortable to me, but it really is. Another thing I've grown accustomed to is clicking on a link and having the link open on the app of the webpage on the empty screen instead of popping on top of your current window like it would on basically any single panel device. It doesn't work all the time thanks to, of course, these software hiccups, but when it does, you do get a glimpse of the future Microsoft envisioned for us. I'm totally for it. Look, I totally get it. Suckers like me are guinea pigs for prototypes, and that's what the Surface Duo is. But that doesn't mean you can't feel satisfied with a product. Take the Samsung Galaxy Z Flip, for example. That's an expensive first generation phone that I loved pulling out of my pocket every single time. It wasn't without its own set of faults, but I can't say I feel the same way about the Surface Duo. Forget the software experience, as this is near unstable for an everyday use phone. Forget the outdated camera technology. I applaud Microsoft for re-entering the ballgame. The smartphone market is a better place with a player like Microsoft innovating in it. While this phone isn't the phone that will change the way we use smartphones, it absolutely has a place in the future of smartphones, just for the marvelous design alone. I just can't wait to get my SIM card out of it.
You know what I like? Likes. You know what I don't like? A non-subscriber. So please subscribe and stay tuned for more.